The stars at night are big and bright. Deep in the heart of Texas, the prairie sky is wide and high. Deep in the heart of Texas, the sage and blue is like perfume. Deep in the heart of Texas reminds me of the one I love. Deep in the heart of Texas. Along the trail, deep in the heart of Texas, the rabbits rush.
Hi, my name is Johnny Guitar, and welcome to the Story of Texas Music. I'll be your host today as we tell that story, or at least the first 100 years of it. Everything in Texas is big, and the story of Texas music is no different. It's a story that begins on the long cattle drives across Texas during the late 1800s. First music to originate from Texas were the early Western songs written by the young cowboys herding cattle along the trail. It's a story that ends 100 years later in the Broadway streets of the Big Apple with the most popular entertainer in America today. What exactly is Texas music? Well, first of all, Texas music is quite unique. We're the only state in the Union to have our own quote-unquote style of music. There's different sounds across America, like the West Coast sound and the East Coast sound, but Texas is the only state to have its own brand of American music. Second, it's difficult to explain exactly what Texas music is because Texas music is not a style of music like country western or rock and roll. If you go to the dictionary, it simply says that Texas music is any original music performed by an inhabitant of the state. If you go to the internet and look up Texas music, it's about the musicians and not the music itself. So Texas music is more about form than it is about style. So to tell the story of Texas music is to tell the stories of the musicians who made the music. During this program, we'll tell those stories. The stories of those Texas artists who have made their mark, not only in Texas music, but in American music as well. You'll hear the story of the early pioneers in American music. Musicians like Scott Joplin, who introduced ragtime music to America. Lead Belly, the first Texas artist to make it big in New York City. And Blind Lemon Jefferson, the first blues artist to make a record. You'll hear the story about the King of Western Swing, who started his career appearing blackface during medicine shows. You'll hear the story of the beloved Texas troubadour, who got drunk one day and tried to shoot a man in the Nashville Bank. You'll hear the story of a young skinny kid with horn-rimmed glasses, who went to New York City to play the all-black Apollo Theater, the first white artist to do so. You'll hear the story of the only musician in American music to have four of his songs in the top 10 record charts at the same time. You'll hear the story about the youngest and the oldest artist to have a number one hit record. You'll hear the story of the redhead stranger, who's been busted so many times for marijuana, Normal made him an honorary chairman. You'll hear the story of a young shy girl named Pearl from Port Arthur, Texas, who went on to become the queen of rock and roll. You'll hear the story of the Pearsall Plowboy, who racked up more number one hits than Elvis and the Beatles combined. Finally, you'll hear the story of a young skinny kid from Oak Cliff, who reinvented Texas music during the 1980s for scores of generations to come. So if you like good stories and good music, sit back, relax, and enjoy 100 years of the best of Texas music. The story of Texas music begins just prior to the turn of the 20th century. At the time, people in Texas were listening to three different types of music. They listened to classical music like Beethoven and Bach. They listened to popular music like Countdown Races and the Old Swanee River. Finally, there was gospel music that people listened to and sung in church on Sundays. The first music to originate from Texas were the early cowboy songs. During the late 1800s in Texas, driving cattle was the primary occupation. Now there was little to do in camp at night except play cards and play music. Soon the young cowboys were singing songs about their experiences out on the trail. Songs like Home on the Range and Get Along Little Doggies and Don't Fence Me In were quite popular in the saloons and dance halls in Texas at the turn of the century. One of the most popular songs to come out of this era was a song called The Cowboy's Lament, or later on, more popularly known as The Streets of Laredo. The song was written by a young cowboy named Frank Maynard. Although born in Iowa, Maynard always dreamed of being a cowboy and moved to Texas as a young man, where he got a job driving cattle. The song that he wrote was an adaptation from an 18th century English ballad that he had heard as a child. That song, In an Unfortunate Lad, was about a young man living in sin until contracting a social disease from which he later dies from. Maynard kept the melody but changed the words to a young cowboy who had been shot and now lay dying in the streets of Laredo, Texas. The song was immensely popular over the years and was recorded by a host of modern day artists. That list includes Burl Ives, Joan Baez, Chet Atkins, and Johnny Cash, to name a few. Most recently, the song was also used as the title track in Larry McMurtry's Western movie epic, The Streets of Laredo. I learned to sing the song when I was in the fourth grade. I sang the song solo during a school music program on Texas Music. 45 years later, and I'm still singing the song.
As I walked out in the streets of Laredo, as I walked out into Laredo one day, I spied a young cowboy all wrapped in white linen, all wrapped in white linen as cold as the clay. I see by your outfit that you are a cowboy. He said this to me as I boldly walked by. Come stand here beside me and hear my sad story. For I'm shot in the chest and I know I must die. It was once in the saddle I used to go dashing. It was once in the saddle I used to go gay. But I went to the whorehouse and then to the guardhouse. Got shot in the chest and I'm dying today. So get six young cowboys to carry my coffin. Get six lovely maidens to carry my pall. Take me down to Green River and lay sod there o'er me, for I am a young cowboy and I know I've done wrong. So beat the drum lowly and play the fife slowly. Play the death march as you carry me along. Take me to Green River and throw clods upon me to soften the clods as they fall on my grave. So we beat the drum slowly and played the fife lowly. We played the death march as we carried him along down to the Green River and lay sod there o'er him. For he was a young cowboy and he knows he's done wrong.
The story of Texas music begins with the first Texas musician of notable distinction. He was an American composer and the pianist who introduced ragtime music to American society. He would later be dubbed the King of Ragtime for his many ragtime compositions. At the turn of the 20th century, he was one of the most popular musicians in America. Joplin disappeared one day in 1917 and was never heard from again. Scott Joplin was born in the country in 1867, just outside of Texarkana, Texas. His father was an ex-slave from North Carolina and his mother, a freeborn black woman from Kentucky. He received most of his serious music education from Julius Weiss, a music professor who had immigrated to the United States from Germany. He tutored the young Joplin until he was 16 years old. Joplin's first big music break came when he was in Chicago for the World's Fair in 1893. Unable to play inside the fairgrounds because of his race, Joplin played the smaller clubs outside the fairgrounds where he introduced his ragtime music to American audiences. By 1897, Joplin's ragtime had become a national craze. He moved to Sedalia, Missouri in 1894, where he published his first and most famous composition, Maple Leaf Rag, which brought him fame and a steady income for life. He moved to St. Louis in 1901, where he continued to compose and publish his music. During his short career, he wrote 44 original ragtime pieces, one ragtime ballet, and two operas. In 1907, he went to New York City to find a producer for his latest opera. While there in New York City, he disappeared one day. His disappearance remained a mystery for some 50 years until being solved in 1974. It was discovered that in 1917, Joplin was picked up by the police after being found incoherent and walking the streets. He was taken to mental ward where he was committed. He later died there, 3 months later at the age of 49. Unable to ascertain his identity, he was buried at John Doe in a pauper cemetery in an unmarked grave in New Jersey. After his grave was discovered in 1974, a marker was placed there later that year. This next video features Scott Joplin's most famous popular song, The Entertainer. The story of Texas music continues with the first Texas musician to make it big in New York City. His name was Lead Belly and he was a three-time loser, doing time in the Louisiana State Pen, when he was discovered by John Lomax, a record producer from the Library of Congress. Lomax visited the Angola State Penitentiary there in Louisiana several times to record Lead Belly. In all, Lead Belly would go on to record well over 100 songs for Lomax. After his release from prison in 1935, Lomax then took Lead Belly to New York City, where he became a big star, appearing on radio and television. Lead Belly was born Hughie Ledbetter in 1888, just across the state line in Louisiana. When he was 5 years old, he moved with his family to Bowie County in Texas, just west of Fort Worth. In the early 1900s, he moved to Dallas, where he became a fixture in the streets of Deep Ellum, Color District, east of downtown Dallas. According to local legend, his nickname derived from the vast amounts of alcohol he could consume in one sitting. It was almost as if he had a quote-unquote lead belly. Lead belly spent most of his early adulthood in prison. In 1917, he was convicted of carrying a pistol and did time on a Harrison County chain gang. He was convicted again in 1918 for killing a man in a fight over a woman and served 7 years in Sugar Land, west of Houston. Then in 1930, he was convicted of knifing a white man and was serving a 7-year sentence at Angola in Louisiana when he was discovered by John Lomax. At the time, Lomax and his son Alan were traveling the American South, recording blues music for the Library of Congress. After his release from Angola in 1935, Lead Belly went to work as a driver for John Lomax. Later that year, Lomax took Lead Belly to New York City, where he made several records for Columbia Records. The newspapers were eager to write about Lomax's new protege, and soon Lead Belly was later featured in a 3-page article in Life magazine, the first black blues artist to do so. In the 1940s, Lead Belly appeared regularly on the groundbreaking CBS radio show, Back Where I Come From. He was also the first blues artist to travel and to tour in Europe and in the Far East. In the latter part of his career, he hosted his own regular radio broadcast on station WNYC on Sunday nights. Lead Belly gave his final performance at the University of Texas in 1949, where he paid tribute to John Lomax, the man who discovered him. He died later that year and was buried in his birthplace in Warring Sports, Louisiana. This next video features Lead Belly's 1934 prison recording of the song, The Midnight Special.
Come a Miss Rosie, how in the world do you know? Well, I know about an April and a dress she wore. I'm a river on the shoulder, piece of paper in her hand. Well, I'm going and ask the governor, he's trying to loosen my man. Let the midnight special shine a light on me. Let the midnight special shine a heavy loving light on me. When you get up in the morning, when that big bell rings, you go to march to the table, be the same damn thing. Knife and fork are on the table, there's nothing in my pain. Never said a thing about it, have a trouble with the man. Let the midnight special let the midnight special shine a ever-loving light on me. Well, I went to the nation and the territory. Well, I thought about a girl I love lived in Mexico. Let the midnight special shine a light on me. Let the midnight special shine a ever-loving light on me. You ever go to Houston, boy, you better walk right. And you better not squabble, and you better not fight. Bass and Brocker will arrest you, Payne and Boone will take you down. You're gonna bet your bottom dollar, and I'll change your rebound. Let the midnight special shine a light on me. Let the midnight special shine a ever-loving light on me. Well, jumping little Judy, she was a mighty fine girl.
The story of Texas music continues with the first Texas musician to make a record. His name was Blind Lemon Jefferson, and he started out as a poor young blind kid with no formal education. At the time of his death in 1929, he was one of the most popular blues singers in all of America. He was also among the inaugural class of blues musicians inducted into the Blues Hall of Fame. Blind Lemon Jefferson was born Lemon Henry Jefferson in 1893 in a small community called Couchman in Freestone County near present-day Wortham, Texas. He was one of eight children born to sharecroppers Alex and Clarissa Jefferson. He began playing the guitar in his early teens, and soon he was performing at church socials and parties. Later on, he became a street musician, playing in front of barbershops and on street corners in the small towns in East Texas. By 1910, Jefferson was playing in the streets of Deep Ellum in Dallas, along with fellow blues musician Leadbelly. In 1917, he met the young T-Bone Walker, whom he taught the basics of blues guitar in exchange for Walker's occasional services as a guide. By the 1920s, he was earning enough money from his music to support a wife and child. Until Blind Lemon Jefferson, very few artists had recorded solo voice and blues guitar. Unlike most artists who were discovered and recorded in their normal venues, Jefferson went to Chicago, Illinois in 1925 to record his first tracks. From 1926 to 1929, he recorded well over 100 songs and made 43 different records. In 1926, he recorded his first two songs, Got the Blues and Long Lonesome Blues. Both songs became a runaway success, with sales in the six figures, and established Blind Lemon Jefferson as one of the most popular blues singers of the 1920s. Fortunately, Blind Lemon Jefferson died of a heart attack in 1929 at the age of 37, after becoming disoriented during a snowstorm. He was later buried at the Wortham Negro Cemetery there in Wortham, Texas. In 1967, a historical marker was placed in his grave, and in 2007, the cemetery officially changed its name to the Blind Lemon Jefferson Memorial Cemetery. Most recently, the state of Texas paid tribute to Jefferson by featuring him on the official state of Texas license plate for music. This next video features Blind Lemon Jefferson's 1927 recording of his most popular song, See That My Grave Is Kept Clean.
What is one kind favor I ask of you? Lord, is one kind favor I ask of you? See that my grave is kept clean. It's a long grave, got no end. It's a long lane, it's got no end. It's a long lane, ain't got no end. There's a bad wind that never changed. Lord, it's too bad, old is in a line. Well, it's too white horse is in a line. Well, it's two white horses in a line. Well, take me to my burying ground. My heart stopped beating, my hand got cold. My heart stopped beating, my hand got cold. Well, my heart stopped beating, Lord, my hands are cold. It wasn't no more serving but time of cold. Have you ever heard a coffin sound? Have you ever heard a coffin sound? Have you ever heard a coffin sound? Then you know that the poor boy is in the ground. Oh, dig my favor, silver spade. Well, dig my grave with a silver spade. Well, dig my grave with a silver spade. You may leave me down with a golden chain. Have you ever?
Story of Texas Music continues with first band leader to front a band with an electric guitar. His name is T-Bone Walker, and he's a member of Rolling Stone magazine's list of the 100 greatest guitarists of all time. Chuck Berry copied his famous duck walk from Walker. BB King went out and borrowed his first electric guitar after watching Walker perform one night. Jimi Hendrix learned to play the guitar with his teeth from watching T-Bone Walker. Walker's also a member of the Blues Hall of Fame and the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. T-Bone Walker was born Aaron Thibault Walker in Linden, Texas in 1910. His parents were both musicians and his stepfather bought him his first guitar. Early in the 1920s, the teenage Walker learned his craft amongst the street rolling string bands of Dallas. His mother and stepfather were both members of the Dallas String Band. By the time he was 15, he was a professional performer on the Blues Circuit. He started out his career billed as Oak Cliff T-Bone. Oak Cliff was where he lived at the time, and the name T-Bone was a mispronunciation of his middle name. In 1929, Walker recorded his first song, Wichita Falls Blues, for Columbia Records. In 1936, he moved to Los Angeles, where he worked the clubs along Los Angeles' Central Avenue. He also performed as the featured singer with Les Heights Orchestra there in Los Angeles. In 1946, he signed with Black and White Records, where he recorded his biggest hit of all time, Stormy Monday. In 1962, he appeared at the American Folk Blues Festival, Memphis Slim, and Willie Dixon, among others. Several critically acclaimed albums followed, such as I Want a Little Girl, recorded for Delmark Records in 1968. He recorded his last years for Jimmy Jane Publishing Company, and his last recording in 1971 earned him a Grammy for the song Good Feeling. T-Bone Walker died of a stroke in 1975 at the age of 64. He was interred at the Inglewood Park Cemetery in Inglewood, California. This next video features T-Bone Walker live on stage at the Apollo Theater in 1971, singing his most successful song, Stormy Night.
They call it Stormy Monday. But Tuesday's just as bad. Call it Stormy Monday. Tuesday's just as bad. Eagle flies on Friday, and Saturday I get out to play. On Friday and Saturday I go out to play. Sunday I go to church. Ah, I kneel down and pray.
Face black and appearing in minstrel and medicine shows in Fort Worth. He would go on to become one of the first Texas musicians to gain national prominence. Along the way, he created his own unique style of music that they later called Western Swing. Throughout his career, he wrote and recorded 470 songs, sold 20 million records, and at one time was the highest paid band leader in the United States. He's a member of the Country Music Hall of Fame, the Songwriters Hall of Fame, and the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. And he's CMT Magazine's 40 Greatest Men in Country Music. James Robert Will was born on a farm in Cossey, Texas in 1905. His father was a champion fiddle player, and he taught Bob how to play the fiddle. When Bob was 14, the family moved to Turkey, Texas, where he remained until he was grown. In 1929, he moved to Fort Worth, where he started out, period, in minstrel and medicine shows there at Stockyards. While in Fort Worth, he formed his first band, the Lake Crush Doughboys. Wills left the band in 1933 and formed another group that he called the Playboys. In 1934, he moved with the band to Tulsa, Oklahoma, where they started appearing on a local radio program as Bob Wills and the Texas Playboys. In 1940, he recorded his first major hit, the San Antonio Rose. The song went on to sell over a million records and established him as Texas's first major superstar in American music. Shortly thereafter, Bob Wills moved to Hollywood, California, where he appeared in over a dozen movies. During the 1940s, his performances were outdrawing those of Tommy Dorsey and Benny Goodman. He scored his last top 10 in 1950 with his most requested song, Faded Love. Bob Wills died of pneumonia in Fort Worth in 1975 at the age of 7. He was buried in Tulsa, Oklahoma, where his career first began. Recently, the Texas legislature adopted a resolution designating his Western Swing music as the official state music of Texas. This next video features Bob Wills and the Texas Playboys playing their signature tune, San Antonio Rose. Story of Texas music continues with the most celebrated blues recording artist of all time. His name was Lightnin' Hopkins, and during his career, he recorded well over 1,000 songs. After his death, the New York Times called him perhaps the greatest single influence on rock and roll guitar players. Rolling Stone magazine included him in his list of the 100 greatest guitarists of all time. Lightnin' Hopkins was born Sam John Hopkins in 1912 in Centerville, Texas. He learned to play the guitar from a distant cousin, country blues singer Alger Texas Alexander. When he was 8 years old, he met Blind Lemon Jefferson at the church picnic. Later on, he started accompanying the blind man in informal church gatherings. In the late 1930s, Hopkins moved to Houston with his cousin Alexander to break into the music business. But by the early 1940s, he was back in Centerville working as a farmhand. Hopkins took another shot at Houston in 1946. While there, he was discovered by Lola Ann Cullum from Los Angeles-based Aladdin Records. She convinced Hopkins to travel to Los Angeles, where he began his recording career. It was a record company that gave Hopkins his nickname, Lightning. He returned to Houston in 1947 and rarely traveled outside of Texas from then on, preferring to perform in his hometown of Houston. In 1959, he was caught up in the folk revival going on in America. In 1960, he was invited to appear at Carnegie Hall alongside Pete Seeger and Joan Baez. In 1964, he was invited to Europe to play at the American Folk Blues Festival in Germany. That next year, he traveled to Japan, where he won an extended six-city tour. In 1967, he appeared in a documentary of his life called The Blues According to Lightning Hopkins. Throughout the 1970s, Hopkins released at least one album a year and performed at most of the major folk festivals, both here and abroad. Lightning Hopkins died of cancer in Houston in 1982 at the age of 69. He was buried there in his hometown of Houston. This next video features Lightning Hopkins performing his rendition of the popular hit Mojo Man live on stage at an Austin City Limits appearance.
Get me a mojo hand. I'm going to Louisiana. I'm going to get me a mojo hand. You know, I'm going to fix my woman so she can't have no other man. I'm thinking about a mojo hand. I lay down thinking, I was thinking about a mojo hand. You know, I want to fix my woman so she can't have no other man. She got another man. Listen at me good. Can a woman act funny? When she got another man. You know she won't look straight at you, did she? Always ready to sing.
The story of Texas music continues with a Texas artist known throughout his career as the Texas Troubadour. He's one of the most influential musicians from Texas, having a music career that spanned well over 40 years. He was a lifetime member of the Grand Ole Opry and was the first to take the Grand Ole Opry to Carnegie Hall in New York City. He's also a member of the Country Music Hall of Fame, and he's the 20th most influential country artist of all time, as ranked by TNT Magazine. His name was Ernest Tubb, and he was born in 1914 on a cotton farm near Crisp, Texas, in Ellis County in northeast Texas. His father was a sharecropper, and Ernest grew up working in the cotton fields. He spent his spare time learning to sing and play the guitar, and was greatly influenced by Jimmy Rogers. He started out singing on the local radio station in San Antonio when he was just 19 years old. A short year later, he was doing his own daily 15-minute live show on a local radio station in San Angelo, Texas. His career took off in 1936 when he contacted Jimmy Rogers' widow to ask for an autographed photo. A friendship developed, and she was instrumental in getting Tubb a recording contract with RCA Records. Having no luck with RCA, he switched to Decca Records in 1940, where he had his first major hit, Walking the Floor Over You. He joined the Grand Ole Opry in 1943 and remained a member for the rest of his life. He put together his first band in the 1950s, the Texas Troubadours, and they were well known for having one of the best bands in all of country music during the 50s and 60s. Also in the early 1960s, he had his own television program syndicated throughout America on Saturday nights called The Ernest Tubb Show. Throughout the 1970s, he continued to play concerts throughout America, and in 1980, he appeared as himself in the movie Coal Miner's Daughter, starring Sissy Spacek. In 1982, Ernest Tubb fell ill with emphysema and died of the illness 2 years later at the Baptist Hospital in Nashville, Tennessee. He was buried in Nashville's Hermitage Memorial Garden Cemetery, and his legacy lives on through his famous record shop there in Nashville. This next video features Ernest Tubb performing his biggest hit, Walking the Floor Over You, live and on stage at the Grand Ole Opry in 1955.
The Texas Troubadour, Ernest Tubb.
Can't sleep a wink, that is true. I'm hoping and I'm praying as my heart breaks right in two. Walking the floor over you. You left me and you went away. You said that you'd be back in just a day. You've broken your promise and you left me here alone. Don't know why you did, dear, but I do know that you're gone. I'm walking the floor over you. I can't sleep a wink, that is true. I'm hoping and I'm praying as my heart breaks right in two. Walking the floor over you. Oh, buddy, Leon. Someday you may be lonesome too. Walking the floor is good for you. Just keep right on walking and it won't hurt you to cry. Remember that I love you and I will the day I die. I'm walking the floor over you. I can't sleep a wink, that is true. I'm hoping and I'm praying as my heart breaks right in two. Walking the floor over you.
The story of Texas music continues with a young country artist from Corsicana, Texas named Lefty. Lefty did something in music in 1951 that no other artist in American music has done before or since. He had four of his songs in the top 10 record charts at the same time. He was also one of the first country artists whose records crossed over into pop music, and he was the first to play Hollywood Bowl in Hollywood, California. Most recently, CMT Magazine included Lefty in his list of the 40 greatest men of country music. William Orville Frizzell was born in 1928 in Corsicana, Texas. Shortly after his birth, he moved with his family to El Dorado, Arkansas. Although called Sonny by the family, he got the name Lefty at the age 14 after a schoolyard scrap. He started playing the guitar early on, and by age 12, he was appearing regularly in the local children's radio program there in El Dorado. By his late teens, he was performing at local fairs and rodeos throughout East Texas. He started his music career at the age of 19. He hosted a half-hour radio show on a small Texas radio station. He got his first major break when record producer Don Law heard him singing live at the Ace Club Springs in Big Spring, Texas. He was soon signed to Columbia Records, where he had a string of hits that broke into the country music's top 10. In 1950, he was invited to perform on the Grand Ole Opry, and the next year he appeared on the Louisiana Hayride for the first time. During the early 1950s, he toured with Hank Williams, where they were billed as the Kings of Country Music. In 1964, he recorded Saginaw Mission, which earned him his first Grammy Award nomination. In the early 1970s, he changed record labels and moved to California. He was the first country artist invited to perform at the Hollywood Bowl. Unfortunately, alcoholism was a recurring problem for Frizzell. Success and money only added to his Frizzell's alcohol addiction. He died in 1975 at the age of 47 of a massive stroke. He was buried in Goodlettsville, Texas. He was later honored with his own statue in his hometown, of course, of Kent. This next video features Lefty Frizzell performing his first number one hit, If You've Got the Money, I've Got the Time, live on stage.
If you've got the money, honey, I've got the time to go honky-tonkin' and we're gonna have a time. We'll make all the night spots dance to the music fine. If you've got the money, honey, I got the time. Well, ain't no use to tarry, so let's start out tonight. We'll spread joy, oh, oh, and we'll spread it right. We'll have more fun, baby, all the way down the line. If you've got the money, honey, I got the time.
You win no more money.